Well, good morning, everybody. It's nice to be here. And hopefully move a little further from further on from where we started a few weeks ago back on my campus. So just to dive into it, I'm going to spend a couple of minutes sort of reiterating, as I did then, how as academics we think about the potential access to data, what matters to us. It's going to up the ante of the discussion of open data a little bit, as I think you got a taste of for the clip, and then introduce the first speaker in our panel, and hopefully we'll keep the presentations short and hopefully give you a chance to interact, especially on some of the areas that may be most interesting or most controversial to you. So let me start by pointing out this. There are two important ways in which the academic community can enormously assist folks in the public sector. One way is that we can do various forms of analyses that you might either not think of or not necessarily have the bandwidth to be able to do in your own environments. So there certainly is some potential advantage of the kinds of questions we can answer and the kinds of talent we can bring to bear on it for obvious reasons. At the same time, although hopefully we won't be standing at your side when we tell the community that we've cured cancer, well, maybe it'd be great if we could, but not prematurely, we also can stand as an important source of validation for certain kinds of information and inferences, which obviously become very important from a political point of view, especially when public officials are pushed into making complex decisions. So that's the upside. So what's the potential downside? Well, as investigators coming from the academic environment, we need data in certain ways, and we need it to have certain characteristics to be of much use. And the first and foremost of those is we need data in a granular form. Lumped, grouped, aggregated statistical data, while extremely important for communication, is frankly virtually worthless from a research point of view. There are ways in which aggregates of data are used from time to time in ecologic studies, but I'm going to give you a mock question in a minute. I think it'll be immediately obvious why granularity is important, which means individual level by and large. The second thing that the data needs to be terribly useful from an academic point of view, is linkable, which means enough identification needs to be available with that data in order to link it to other data sets. Individual data sets by themselves may be wonderful for describing the way things are, which in and of itself may be an extremely important political step and public health act or act of other political importance, but by and large doesn't lead to any new insights or new policy opportunities. Unfortunately, the third thing that academic needs their data to be is shareable. Now, that doesn't mean throwing it up publicly so that everyone can look at identifiable data, far from it, but it does mean that data needs to be in some ways reproducible by others, because that's the way the scientific community works. Privately analyzed data, however fascinating, is frankly not data that should be used for public purposes or for any policy purposes, because until others have looked at it, frankly, it's not clear what can be said about it in terms of its validity and its utility. And if all of that weren't enough of a potential burden for the public-private partnership in this space, the data for at least a brief window in time needs to be ownable. And by ownable, I don't mean take it away in a box and use it for some purpose other than what was intended. But academics need to be able to publish their work, and they need to be able to publish it at least for some window in time without worrying that someone's about to publish it the day before or undermine the ability to do that, because it is what it is, the grist by which we promote and do other things within our own environment. So those are four characteristics of data sharing with academics that at least raise challenges to the data sharing movement. So I just want to leave you with a simple example before I introduce our next speaker. So imagine we wanted, just, you know, the ongoing saga in Flint makes me think of this. Imagine we wanted to learn something about lead poisoning and the relationship between lead poisoning and subsequent life events, interactions with the social service networks, interactions with the Department of Justice, school performance. Imagine the form we would need data in order to draw strong inferences which would suggest that one or another intervention early in life would actually make a difference in terms of late life outcomes. Without granular individual level data, we just couldn't do it. And that's just an example of the way data from many different sources might be linked to answer questions of critical today public health policy ideas. So I just leave you that with a sort of a paradigm when you think about, oh, what do they mean? That's what I mean. So with that, I'll introduce Phil Leaf, who probably needs no introduction. Phil has been in this space far longer than I have. He has been a professor of mental health in the public health school at Johns Hopkins and has so many center and departmental affiliations, I can't even list them all.
So, a disclaimer, my degree is in sociology. I am not going to cure any diseases. There are two things that academics have that are value and have importance. One is publications, and some of what you alluded to is, well, what are the criteria for having a publication? And to some extent, it's if you're publishing in a high-quality journal, it's for other people to be able to understand and potentially even access the data sets to see whether you analyze them correctly, whether they replicate, which is a way of translating the need for being able to get access to the data. The second is, I need funds. I am a tenured professor at Johns Hopkins, which means that as long as I bring in 90% of my salary, and the average for my department is if we're not covering 90% of the salary of our faculty, we run a deficit, which means I have to bring in more than 90% for myself and the junior faculty I support. So again, what is the realm of being able to write grants, get grants, develop collaborations is one of the things that academics filter these things through. But I think that, let me ask you, how many of your organizations or you personally on your job in your organizations are going to be involved in solving the question of how are you going to eliminate a disease, whether it's cancer, mental disorders, alcoholism. Okay, that's not the vast majority of you. How many of you are involved in trying to make sure that information about diseases, health, well-being, human services are as widely distributed and understood as possible, and that we're getting the most maximum outcome of what we know about health and well-being? How many of you involved in that part of the problem? Okay, so I'm partially in the right place, because again, I am not going to eliminate a disease, but part of my interest is in making sure what we know is being adequately used. And I think, again, that's although we may need granular data, there are many things that don't require individuals, that looking at the context, I do a lot of work across counties, across school systems, there's enormous across healthcare providers, enormous variations in the outcomes that those individuals groups are producing that I need to understand those contexts, which are not necessarily, that are characteristics. Okay, so I'm going to give a couple examples very quickly. Jonathan Gross, who's an epidemiologist in the Baltimore City Health Department, actually did all the slides except the last one, because my question to him was, what do people need to know about how you're using open data, how we are collaborating with you on open data activities to better understand some of the opportunities? And so one of the things he first pointed out is that open data is sometimes mistaken as being not valuable. It really is valuable both to the researchers and to those who are involved in trying to improve health and well-being. And that, as you heard already today, and you're going to hear for the next day and a half, there are huge advances in getting access to the kind of data that are available, whether you're a local health department, a state health department, the federal agencies, that there's more data available now than ever. So here's a map of Baltimore, and you don't need to be able to, Baltimore has lots of these neighborhoods and stuff, and all you need to know is that red has very low health life expectancies, relatively low, averaging 66 years or more, and the blue areas where I live in Baltimore, you know, we average 76 to 85 years of annual. And again, looking at Baltimore City, which is not the hugest city, not the most population city, we have huge variations, and some of those variations are less than a mile apart. We're not talking about over huge geographic differences, great differences in life expectancy, health, drugs, income, transportation. We have the second longest commuting time for any city in the country, second only to Los Angeles, because we have very few jobs left in Baltimore. Many of our people do not have cars, so they have to take public transportation. They are averaging over an for the whole entire city over an hour and a half commute per day to each way to get to their job. That's not total. That's to get to their job and to get back. This is equivalent Los Angeles is only the only place, city in the country that has a longer average commute. But we're also talking about, in Los Angeles, it's their cars. And we're talking about people who don't have cars, who, you know. So there's a lot of things you just need to know, there's variations. Again, open data, they were able to look at the estimates of health insurance. Again, coverage of health insurance by the neighborhood levels. We have huge variations in our city of who's actually covered. And that makes a big difference if we're trying to understand access and other kind of things. It also, you can sort of see the little H's. And Q's, H's are hospitals, Q's are federally qualified health centers. There's a lot of people who would really benefit from understanding this information, understanding these things. And as you can sort of see, he has on these things, again, the links where these are open data. These were generated so people in those groups could get access to those. Firearms and issues of violence. So that's a hospital. That hospital is the Bonsecour Hospital in Baltimore City, had the largest number, had 39 homicides within 1/4 mile. This is 1/4 mile of this hospital. We're not talking about its catchment area. We're talking about 1/4 mile. It is not a trauma center. Johns Hopkins is the trauma center for children in Baltimore City. Shock Trauma, University of Maryland, is the trauma center for adults. But obviously, there's a lot of people that are getting, everybody who's shot is not going to be on life support. Unfortunately, some of those people actually don't survive. But if we're thinking about where to do interventions on trauma-informed things, as well as how trauma is impacting the lives of people in those neighborhoods, we could have gone out more than 1/4, but this is like a lot of shootings within 1/4 mile. They don't fall off across the block. But again, using data to understand this, because we do the same thing with schools. We've had schools that have had 17 shootings within 1/4 mile. How do you think that impacts the children's health, their ability to go to school? So there's a lot of these data, again, and these are open data. I mean, I get every week, well, I get literally sort of every day incidents around within 3 miles of where I work, because there's a public group, that already publishes that. But the data, the police are getting these things up with 2 weeks lag time around shootings, all their arrests are up now on our open data. So looking at these kind of things are very important, and you know, being exposed to these things, so if you're interested in substance use arrests or other things, those are all there. Likewise, opiate use, prescription opiate use, we find huge variations there. So the point he said, start early, be bold, search, work in teams. And again, just for people who want to log on, these are the sort of the sites of the data that he's using. And we have insurance data, social determinants of health, shooting incidents, health incidents, should I add school. And I just do this, not that you can see this. This is Baltimore variations. We've developed this, the academic part is using these data. The left is healthy data, healthy neighborhoods of the 55 neighborhoods. By below is low. You can sort of see not that there's not linear, but there's huge variations. So understanding the outcomes for individuals, where people come from, doctors' outcomes are really important. We also have many more people living. The bar lines are number of children living under 19, 18 who are living in those neighborhoods. And you can sort of see we have large numbers of people living in the most disadvantaged neighborhoods. So I think, again, there's lots of opportunities for collaboration. Open data is becoming increasingly available. And with that, I'm going to introduce the next speaker, Aenor Sawyer, who's the Associate Director of Strategic Relations at UCSF, the Center for Digital Health Innovation, and the Director of the UCSF Skeletal Health Service. So.
Thank you. We're going to switch this over. Yeah, thank you. This is a great opportunity. I'm very excited to be here today. I am an orthopedist and I direct the Skeletal Health Service, so I have 1 foot still in clinical work, but I get to work in health informatics and in digital health at UCSF. So very fortunate to be walking both sides of it, but one thing really does tell me what I should be working on the other side.
I think you may have to.
So my talk
here a second.
Okay, so What I'm working on today and presenting to you is just to hit the tops of the waves of some of the work that we're doing at UCSF, and hopefully you'll see opportunities where you could intersect with what we're doing. And then in addition, to throw out some ideas of where we might be able to go further with leveraging data in health and wellness.
There we go.
Great. Okay. So. Let's take away here.
Clicker. Yeah.
Not sure how to modify that. Great. Okay. So very quickly, very quick hit on healthcare, what our university is working on, and then what I call the data reach. Instead of the data breach, I thought that would be refreshing just to call it the data reach, of places where I think we could go if we could truly leverage data in healthcare better. This slide just simply represents healthcare to me. The system's broken, but we still have to function in it. We still have to take care of people in the system the way it is. Also, it represents the seismic shifts happening in healthcare and the fact that we have to make decisions constantly without enough information. Even though there's more and more data available, we aren't leveraging it well enough. So this slide sums up healthcare to me. I won't go through all the seismic shifts that are going on, but I think many of you know them, and you can see that there are challenges and opportunities around health informatics under each one of these. And another really important movement we should pay attention to is the empowered patient. They have more information. There's a culture shift where patients want to have more choice and more decision-making in their healthcare, and I completely embrace that. And they're also stepping up and saying, I want to contribute my information. So even though we as a system have to be advocates for privacy and security around health data, the patients are starting to step up. And so that's something that we can leverage of the patient being a vector to getting their data available for research. It's a very large system. Many of you know we have multiple campuses. The great thing is it allows us to have intersection with multiple sectors that just in healthcare alone we might not contact. So we leverage our relationships with our environmental sciences, our engineers, our design thinkers, et cetera, across all the campuses. This is an example of some open data that's coming off of some of the other campuses. Many of you know UC Santa Barbara has fantastic computational sciences and computational health sciences. These are some of the open data sets that they've made available a long time ago. Another example of open data is from UC Santa Cruz and this fantastic lab where they've offered up the genome browser that they've built and also the encyclopedia of DNA elements. And this is a very powerful tool. If you haven't accessed this before, it's really good to look at. The UC Health Enterprise alone is massive, 17 health professional schools. We have 14 million patient lives in a record set that we're aggregating now across the UC systems, which is very powerful. We have research data that we're intersecting across campuses now as well. So the UC Health Network is finally coalescing and creating economy of scale around our practices, but also our ability to intersect data within our healthcare system. There's also an initiative called the California Digital Library, and this is a really important way for the materials that we've amassed across UC campuses, the information to be digitized and made available to more people. In the process of doing that, they've also helped us support how we manage data for our researchers and also how that data is now becoming more shared. And again, getting through some of the cultural barriers of sharing data, our researchers are now finding benefits in sharing data in ways that create hybrid vigor rather than the true conflict or competition that we were concerned about. And the timing of that is important as well, of when it's shared. This is just to show you that we are one of the number one NIH-funded schools, so we are generating lots and lots of data, and how we leverage that and how we intersect that with open data and other types of multi-sector data is very important. Traditionally, there's been a lot of informatics going on in cancer. Our Clinical Trial Sciences CTSI, bioinformatics led by Ida Sim, who I think participated in one of these events at Stanford. We have consultation, but we also have training. We're now not just training informatics to people who want to specialize in it, but we're integrating it now in an initiative we did with the AMA this year into our actual traditional medical school training, because our clinicians, not just our researchers, need to have data science expertise. They need to be fluent in informatics in all of our health professions now, because that's a new tool that we haven't really learned to use before, but we need to in the way we think about healthcare now. We've also been leveraging open data sets for a long time in our community health labs, et cetera, and this is CELDAC out of CTSI. These are open data sets that our researchers have access to. Precision medicine, as you know, is leveraging lots of data across different sectors. It's very exciting, the genomics, the biome, et cetera. What we need to make that really work, though, is we need a knowledge network. We need the data from basic clinical social behavioral sciences and all the devices that are now available to us. We need these to intersect and create a knowledge base out of that, algorithms, et cetera, that can help us individualize risk prediction, evaluation, and therapeutics for patients. But it is a very exciting time. We have more data available than ever before, all the way from the genome and the phenome, all the way out to what I'm now calling the phonome, which is consumer analytics. So that is information that is available that we haven't really leveraged yet and made associations with physiologic and biologic data, let alone genomic data. Very exciting. We've got all this data that sits in machines that we've never leveraged and intersected well. Now we've got all this coming at us, which is exciting. But just to point out, these need to be validated. The consumer wearables are, we're finding, are quite unreliable. Even if we validate them against each other, there's drift, et cetera. So this information can be very valuable, but we have to figure out how do we validate it and how do we get it built to higher standards so we can really trust it, as you said before. Now we have data coming at us from hybrid devices that are not just consumer but medical grade, but out there, remote monitoring, and we need to know how to incorporate that information. So we think we're on the front of the wave in a lot of ways, but we're really just standing in front of this massive wave of data that we haven't leveraged well. So we started the Center for Digital Health Innovation. We do innovation, we do validation, we do education, but we've really focused on this in the last year. Because what we've been finding is that all this health information, to get from the promise to the power, we've actually got to get the acquired data into some actionable information. It's got to be contextualized and it's got to move to the right place at the right time. So we really zeroed in on interoperability. We have all these systems running in our hospital that don't intersect with our EHR. These are just IT systems in the hospital that we've had to create bridges for over the last couple of decades. We realized all our colleagues in healthcare were doing this, and none of these were scalable because these were one-off bridges we were doing. And the interoperability reports that came out of ONC pointed out health interoperability gaps generate billions of dollars of waste and loss every year, and almost 250,000 lives lost that could be prevented. So we looked very hard for a partner, because this is the point of industry-academic relationships. We realized we were building our little fixes, but we could not possibly scale this into something that would be more meaningful and useful across the healthcare systems. So we partnered with Cisco. And the reason we did, we looked long and hard, but we needed a tech titan who could really facilitate this and looked across their work in end-to-end data journeys and leveraging data and impacting industries all the way from manufacturing, retail, energy, finance, et cetera, and realized that we thought they had the capacity. So this is a very rough schematic. I won't spend time on this. I'm going to scoot forward. But this is to say that the ONC says it'll take a decade to have an interoperability platform that's functioning well. We're going to have proof of concept within 9 months. So please, if you're interested in this idea of health interoperability, please talk to us. We'd love to partner with you and understand what your pain points are. In addition, in this past year, we were able to recruit Atul Butte, sorry, Mark, to the Institute of Computational Health Sciences. Some of you have seen his work already. These are some simple examples, but he's doing work at the level of State of California to help integrate health data as well as in the UC system. And also combining our precision medicine initiatives with Atul's work and the interoperability platform, we've now been listed as one of the centers that the White House will be leveraging. So the reach part of this is that I think I would love to promote this idea of informed health. And we lead informed lives. So in the palm of my hand, I can ask questions to get across town or book a restaurant, et cetera, and I get the pertinent information pushed to the moment of decision making, and it optimizes my choice. In healthcare, we leverage data mostly retrospectively. We lead informed lives, but we don't have informed health yet. So for me, that's pushing informatics and digital health innovation and healthcare delivery all together, and we do this in a meeting now once a year. And it's really getting the right info at the right instant to get the best outcome. That's informed health, and I'd love for that to be one of our data reaches. And this is, I'll skip that slide, we can come back to it if you want. But the other data reach for me is putting health in context. Put the human health in context of the health of the home, in the health of the city, and in the health of the planet. And we can do that now with the work you're doing with open data sets across multiple sectors and with, for example, Cisco and other industries' capabilities to leverage data across different industries and intersect it. So cross-sector, multi-sector data, putting human health in the context. I think human health is the canary in the coal mine for many of those other sectors' health, including the health of the planet. Thank you. Sure.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Anne Neville. I'm the director of the California Research Bureau at the California State Library. And as we're getting up my slides, I'll just give you a little bit of background. I'm going to start from a little bit of a different perspective, and that is a government program that was looking to create and then release a new open data set for the first time. So we were collecting data that had not been collected before and then opening it up. As you will see, it is not directly health related. It's something called the National Broadband Map, which is was a six-year program that just finished. And the broadband map was the first national and open data set of broadband availability. Granular for us, very granular for us, was census blocks, and in census blocks larger than 2 square miles road segments. This was a tremendous step forward. Prior to this, any data in this area had been basically at census tract and zip code. So this was a huge change in being able to look at neighborhood level access. And obviously, related to lots of different issues related to health, obviously things like EMRs, things like telehealth, don't happen unless there is broadband access. So we had 25 million new records that we were putting up every month. Data was being collected by each one of the 50 states, and then we were taking that data and putting it together at the national level for a national data set. And it was a really new opportunity to study broadband access in the U.S. and to link it to other issues going on at a neighborhood level. So as we thought about what we were planning to do, we looked at our stakeholder groups. We knew policymakers were huge. There's millions and millions of dollars that go either subsidized to individuals or to corporations or now through the FCC to communities every year. We looked at advocates who were looking at local and at state and at national levels, and we looked at researchers, very specifically. The organization that I worked for, and to be clear, I am no longer there, so I'm sort of speaking on behalf of the person who ran that program, but not for the organization. NTIA, which is the National Telecommunications and Information Administration, that was always a mouthful to say, had existing relationships with telecommunications researchers. So they were informal. We all saw each other at the same conferences every year. There's sort of one large telecommunications policy conference that happens every year. And there would be sort of quarterly check-ins because we also did a lot of work with census data. We were the folks who were writing the questions that went into the American Community Survey around broadband and internet access. So there was an existing relationship. And we thought as we were getting this data set up for the very first time. And there was, frankly, internally a lot of pressure on us to succeed. There were a lot of folks who said this could have been done cheaper and easier. There were a lot of folks that said the government shouldn't be doing this. There were a lot of people who said there's no way this will be granular enough to do anything useful. We need address level data, which didn't exist. And so we thought, how do we start building a partnership with some of the people who we hope are going to be able to use this data? And so we actually sent out a Federal Register notice, and we did a call out to researchers. And we said, if you are interested in doing research on this data, we will give you access to it before it's public. And in And what we would like back is for you to share your results with everybody. And so we had 7 research groups from across the country, from a number of different universities who replied. 7 probably doesn't sound like a lot, but in this field and with the timeline we gave, which was very short, it was a couple of months. The fact that we got 7 people, including we got the Berkman Center at Harvard, who is incredibly always at the vanguard on these issues, and at Northwestern and Georgia Tech, who've always been doing great work there. And so then folks had a couple of months. There were one of the things that was very useful to us was that people came back and said, this isn't, you know, I found a problem as I've been going through this data. And we were able to make changes before it went fully public. And then we put an event together at the National Press Club about a month after the data, after we launched the National Broadband Map. And all 7 of the research groups came. They all did presentations on what their initial findings were, talked about whether they were going to be able to go on. Mike talked about taking criticism earlier. One of the research groups did not have a lot of great things to say about the data. They were actually not looking for how they could link it with other data sets. They were talking about everything they'd found that was wrong. And that was challenging, but it was also the nature of the beast. And we knew that going in, and we were prepared to say, okay, how do we take that to continue improving this data set? So we thought, this was really successful. We started creating these relationships. So we built out a dedicated space for the researchers on our wiki. It never got used. We created a researcher working group. There was initial interest, but it wasn't sustained. And we considered grants we were not typically a grant-making organization with researchers. We considered small grants to try to fund ongoing research. So that didn't work. Why? So we had very limited staff, which meant that the kind of work, sustaining a wiki, in case anyone is thinking about it, it takes work. Conversation doesn't naturally evolve on its own. You get a couple people who are really interested and everyone else kind of sits back. If you really want to have people engaged, you have to really try to moderate that conversation. There was not a lot of external funding available from funders on this topic, because they didn't know how trustworthy the data was yet. At the time, they had been already funding some of the groups out there who were working on this data. They hadn't put that in their research plan. So people were already focused on other things because the data wasn't there initially. And then I think just a very practical point, there was very limited funding. There were a lot of questions internally about whether grants to researchers would be the most effective. And also within the policy environment that we were in, there was a lot of work at the national level going on to increase broadband access. And again, the perils, the wonderful things and perils of open data is that people can go and do whatever they want with it. And that may not always be the best bet for a policy organization. So we did regularly answer questions from researchers about metadata and data collection efforts. This was something that was an ongoing thing. We probably got calls once a month from people from PhD dissertations to people working on funded research. And we also did a lot of review of academic papers. And basically, from the government perspective, from my perspective is when I was running a large open data project, is if the data is problematic, we would so much rather hear from you before you publish a paper talking about how crappy the data is. And that's because even just the heads up is helpful, but there may also be communication issues going on. The way we described our metadata may not be a way that was understandable to you and may have created a communication barrier. And then the other piece was specific feedback leads to specific results. When we're talking about detailed data, being able to tell us exactly when went wrong, and we had people who were like, in row 23,226,541, you have a null that there shouldn't be, and when we were trying to run this, it created a huge error. So helpful, because we were able to then act on it and change it. So that is just a quick summary. Feel free to reach out at the State Library or at Anne Neville. Thank you.
And you want to introduce Erika?
Yes. And next up, Erika Martin, who is coming from University of Albany, the State University of New York, and she is an associate professor in the Department of Public Administration and Policy.
So I'll start by saying that I had a health background, but now I'm at a College of Public Affairs, so I don't cure cancer either. So the way that I got invited to this panel is that I've actually spent the last 2 years of my life trying to study really systematically how can we do a better job of integrating researchers like myself into the open data ecosystem. So as everyone in this room knows, open data are targeting multiple users, from journalists to developers. But there's a little less work on thinking through how do we get researchers more involved in this process. And New York is an interesting case because we're an early innovator. So the project motivation here is that although users have different desires and needs, government agencies have very limited guidance on how you can tailor your data products for the different user communities. And so we did a three-part study where we first actually did a pretty systematic review of what's in three different open data portals. We did some interviews with practitioners, actually some folks in this room, about what are some of the challenges and opportunities to publishing data. And then we actually tried a pilot open data linkage project where we said, you know, let's take the data and actually do a real academic ecological research project with it. So the guiding framework for our project is that there's a bunch of different characteristics of data use. So this is on the left-hand side. So they're characteristics of the data. They're characteristics of the user, such as your intended use, your expertise, what kinds of things you want to do with the data. And there's characteristics of different open data platforms and the kinds of user trainings. All of these interact in a unique way, depending on the user, to create a set of conditions under which we would call data high quality and very usable for a specific purpose. So this defines what the intrinsic data quality would be, the contextual data quality, which would differ across users and what they want, and platform usability and also the quality of metadata. And in a perfect world, all of these align. Users have data that they would define as being high quality and usable for their purposes. Data become valuable, they get used, and we have these great short and long-term impacts on health. So that's a perfect world. So the first part of our project, we actually did a very systematic review of open data offerings across three platforms. So we looked at healthdata.gov, the federal platform, healthdata.new york, which is the first open health data platform from a state that's devoted to health. And then we also looked at New York City. And we found that there were a lot of different data offerings, that they're new, they're exciting, but not surprisingly, with the academics on this panel, many of these data offerings are really not designed for academic health research. So surprising to us, only 1/4 of these offerings are structured data sets, so the kinds of things that academics are looking for. Most of them do not contain demographic variables that we need for our analyses. Open data platforms are evolving really rapidly, so there was a lot of variation in terms of their quality and their usability. There were gaps in meeting open data deployment criteria, so this is something that hasn't yet been discussed today, but one thing that you would really want is sort of this 5-star data that are open, they're downloadable, they're hyperlinked to other data sources to provide context, so there's a lot of gaps there. And that although the platforms are really exciting, so Socrata has done some great work to put in some neat functions, there's still a lot of areas for improvement in terms of just technical problems and different kinds of tools that would be helpful. So the second part of this is that academics like myself, we're very whiny, we're demanding, so we want all sorts of things with data, but I think we have less of a sense of what it takes to release a data set. So we actually talked with policymakers and practitioners in New York and federal agencies, and we elicited a really wide range of perceived benefits. So the external benefits aren't really surprising. They're talking about different ways that open data can advance the triple aim of health. What was surprising to us is that government officials talked a lot about internal benefits to their agencies. So they're describing how the process of releasing data actually can improve their data and their metadata quality. and how it's led to some more efficient public health operations in terms of breaking down data silos, reducing FOIA requests. And people extensively talked about how new users can bring these fresh and innovative ideas that they might not have the bandwidth to do. But in doing this work, there are a lot of challenges. So anyone here who's releasing data, you know these. So people told us that, you know, open data is not a technical problem, that that's the easiest part of this. The critical challenge is that this is really a management challenge. So there's issues with breaking down data silos, cultural resistance. There's a lot of legal and regulatory issues. So when I talked to the folks from our legal department, New York State Department of Health, they handed me a stack this high of all the regulations that they're trying to work through. But that there really is some general optimism that these challenges can be overcome and that the data movement really can continue if we continue to have some great leaders who could advance this work. So our last project is a pilot data linkage project. So we really wanted to test out and say we have an academic idea. Can we do this with open data sources only? That was our rule. So there's a very famous data set of childhood obesity in New York State. This was actually used a lot in some recent news stories. And so we wanted to match those data along with a bunch of other open data sets to see how does this relate to the built environment. And so what we found is that there are a lot of data sets that are readily available for public health research, which is exciting. So we got data from different domains that, like health, agriculture, and education that would have been very difficult to do before. And we're able to use the data creatively. So for example, we didn't have funding to get fast food availability, so we're able to use the food safety inspection data to actually create this measure, which was free, so that's exciting for research. But we found that some of the challenges to using the data were pretty consistent with what we found in the other phases of the study. So I think the hardest one is that there are lack of standard definitions for data elements. So this really, really constrains interoperability and our ability to merge by geographic identifiers. So this is something that academic researchers really need. We found really incomplete metadata. We had data quality issues with incorrect data, a very high level of geographic aggregation, which limits the value. And a lot of the data are actually not easily discoverable, even though they're supposed to be. So we actually had to do a lot of sleuthing here. So kind of the end of this journey, I'm cautiously optimistic. I think that we really can have a lot of potential for academic research, but we really need to start thinking collectively about how do we improve the quality of the data to make this movement continue to go forward.
Well, thank you all. We have a small change at the end of our program here. Emily Putnam Hornstein, who you saw briefly in her polemic on our little clip before the panel this morning, unfortunately had a family emergency and couldn't make it. But we are very fortunate to have a former colleague of mine, Regan Foust, who until about 3 weeks ago was part of the Stanford team, has joined Emily in the Children's Data Network at USC and will be our discussant this morning.
Well, thank you all and for the generous introduction. I am a poor substitute for Emily, but I'll try my best. Thank you all for your points. We covered a lot of ground here, but I actually thought that I might frame my discussion on the opening remarks of Mark. So Mark really underscored the importance of the following elements when we're considering data and the importance of it to researchers: granularity, the ability for it to be linked, shareable, and ownable, right? So those themes emerged throughout. So in the area of shareability, the points that stuck out to me were, you know, we saw a few different ways that the data could be transformed into something that is either visual or qualitative. There are many ways of presenting information, but it was that translation piece that made the most difference. An eye toward the audience and what would resonate with them, make sense to them. We also heard about the ownability and some examples, you know, of collaboration among the departments, agencies, organizations, and academic research institutions. It seems like that's an area that's ripe for innovation, and it seems like there's a lot of interest on the stage for pursuing those innovative opportunities. So that's great. Granularity and linkability. So this is the area that really resonated with me. We heard a lot about how, yes, the data can vary widely in terms of quality and usability, and I really appreciate the study, the deep dive into there. I'd love to know the results of what you found, the details, the granular data. And we heard, too, about the importance of interoperability and maybe conversely, the lack of standard data elements. I think that this is one of the biggest barriers that researchers can run into. We spend a lot of time massaging data, not concerning way, but in a way that would make the data our ability to talk about it, make sense of it, and then actually move our field forward. The knowledge network that you brought up was so fascinating, and it harkened back to my training as a graduate researcher. Bronfenbrenner's socio-ecological model of development, ring any bells? How basically, in order to really get a sense of anything that's going on with a child and also society, is really to understand that children are embedded within context of their family, who are then embedded within the context of a neighborhood, and then in a school, and you know it continues on. And the ability for us to actually get that complete picture relies upon our ability to link those data together. And so I applaud you for recognizing that. Yeah, and I think that it was presented, too, that providing data in context is a data reach. And I would say that the new models of analysis and the recognition that we can link, in particular, agency data together would make this more of a reality than you might think. So, I would say that to just sum up, in order to make a complete picture of children and families in California, it really stuck out to me that everybody mentioned, a commitment to making things better, but also the relationships and partnerships that have to exist, not just between ourselves and other researchers, but also between agencies and breaking down those silos. And so I'm heartened that everybody is, who's here, we're obviously committed to making things better, but also that you're sitting among the people that you might be working with. And so introduce yourselves and let's get to work.
So as we did in Palo Alto, we talked too much. Something about researchers and people that deal with researchers, we talk too much. I will shut up and take questions. I'm going to leave the panel here. I will stay here. We've got 15 minutes for a little dialogue. I certainly think they teed up a few areas for discussion. Andy.
So I'm curious to know, here we are situated in the state of California, and I think my question is, we know whether it's the state of California, Maryland, or New York State, states have a treasure trove of data. And I take to heart what you said, Mark, that you need, as a researcher, not the aggregated open data, you need the individual level data. So I'm kind of curious to know, how are our states doing in terms of making these data available to you guys for your research purposes? And if they're not doing well, are there good examples out there that you're aware of, a state somewhere that is doing a really good job, knowing that when it comes to health data, it's often the states that have some really good stuff, so.
Anyone want to take a gander?
All right, so I can talk a bit about the New York experience, and especially with the New York State Department of Health. So my open data journey began when I helped organize a workshop with New York State Department of Health practitioners and academic researchers at SUNY, and we did a lot of whining about the data we wanted. So one of the challenges is that I'm able to get a lot of data, but that's because I've worked really hard to build relationships with folks in the HIV Bureau. But it's hard for external researchers to understand what's there. So I see some of the promises open data is that we can finally understand what resources exist. And through some of the detailed metadata pages, there's an about section where you can actually finally learn who's the data owner. So whereas the data that's on open data might not be right for research purposes, at least it's like an initial way to find out what's there. So at the time, New York had sort of this strategy with level one, level two, and level three, where level three is sort of like the really good stuff researchers want. unfortunately, Dr. Shaw left New York, so he left a great legacy that he's now here in California, you get him. So I think that that's sort of some of the promise.
Phil, I just wondered whether from your Baltimore and Maryland experience, given where how far ahead Maryland is.
Researchers have never had problems getting individual level data. Now, maybe for a particular agency or something is a problem, because essentially we're able to go through Human Subjects Committee to say we're going to hold this stuff confidential, we're not going to release the things, and so getting individual data has never been a problem. It's the open data is having lots of people be able to have access to these kind of data, which allows us to better understand what the data really mean. I mean, we've always been able to get Medicaid data at the individual client level. We've been able to get hospital, if we could develop a collaboration with this particular hospital or healthcare provider and get dumped all their data, as long as we're saying we're gonna have it on a server, that nobody's gonna be able to access it, nobody's gonna be able to look at these things. We go through a Human Subjects Committee. So I think the difference between this is having more access, but also the understanding of these things, and I really like the example of, if we're not making a change in terms of how these data are actually used by whether it's the healthcare providers or individuals themselves in their lives, I think that's where open data are going to, not so much at the research part. I think there's huge numbers of research questions about how do we make these things more accessible? How do we make these things more useful? And I think that's really the window that is being opened up by these open data discussions, whether it's the individual person about how, you know, again, I think the example is I'm always looking at restaurant reviews and things and how far away I am. And I can log on instantaneously. Do they have an opening there? We, you know, at that level, well, how do we do this at healthcare? How do we really make these things more in terms of individual health behaviors or understanding these kind of things? And that's where I think, again, the open data and the sharing, because we need to understand both what the data looks like, but also how it's being best used, and what are the ways of making these apps more accessible, more efficient, so that that you get a smaller number of restaurants that you might be interested in, or a smaller number of healthcare providers, or a smaller number of healthcare strategies that are decisions amongst medications that you might be wanting to do, as a difference between researchers, which what we could always do, and now with an open healthcare environment, open data environment, we're going to be able to do.
So I just want to push you a little bit on that, because I think experiences may differ, and I think Maryland may be unique in certain kinds of ways. But have you had any experience, given that you come from the sort of the broadly speaking, the mental health side, you're not curing cancer, as you pointed out. Have you had success doing, for example, the same thing that you've, same successes you've had with getting, for example, Medicaid data or other insurance claims level data and so forth, the same success with Department of Justice or education or social service agencies in Maryland? Because those are some of the areas, I think, in California where the issues are sharpest and where the dividing lines have been most problematic.
Absolutely. Actually, let me give you an example of what one of my students did as a dissertation. Had the individual arrest data for people going into prison. Now, we know that many people who go into prison in Maryland, they're getting arrested for substance abuse.
That's a very big data set. I'm just kidding.
Right. But she was able, as a graduate student, be able to sort of link these things. And now those data actually are being made publicly available. And again, maybe because Maryland, we only have 24 counties. You know, it's a small, relatively geographically small state. All the agencies are located, most of them are located in Baltimore City, so being able to talk to universities. But there's been, now, essentially, having access to the data and being able to use them and keep the data are different things and for the period of time. But people have been able to sort of link these things and then make them publicly available, sort of de-identified. Again, if you have certain demographics in your certain state, you can get a county you can identify. So again, sometimes we have to eliminate people from these data sets because you can just find out about them. But I think in Maryland,
partially because we have a governor's office that really has been working on collaborating across the different state agencies. We've had some really nice opportunities for academics and also across the different agencies to be able to bridge these data sets. Some of them are located at the University of Maryland now, where they've actually moved their data sets to them, where they actually are owning the state data sets and making the data available for the local agencies, because the governor and the state put the money into the university to be able to do some of these data collaboratives. Other places, I know they're doing at the state level, but I think there's been some really nice advances
great.
There.
No, it's an enviable experience, and perhaps we have a great deal to learn here about things that have worked there. We've got a few more minutes. Do we have some more questions? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. We got one over here. We'll come back to you.
Well, I'd sort of comment in that it was somewhat addressed, because in that I think that open data, it's a mistake to conflate the discussion of individual level health record data needed for researchers and open data. They're just not, you know, same. If you can't publish on it, then it doesn't seem like it's the discussion that needs to happen together. But the issue of what level of geographic granularity, that's critical, you know, and how granular we can get for what types of purposes, and thinking about, you know, there's been a lot of productive academic activities, the Global Burden of Disease Project, and of course Nancy Krieger's work at Harvard in public health geocoding disparities activities. They've published quite a bit looking at the granularity of the data, how granular can get, what does it say about communities, and ecologic data, from a researcher's point of view, has tended to have sort of a bad name. It's just correlation, no kind of causation, but it does depend on what side of the equation you're looking at. And looking at granular descriptions of communities and their interrelationships seems like where things are really at right now in terms of understanding the community correlates of the problems that they have. Those are the individual drivers as well. So I think that maybe academics need, I think they are putting that hat on, but I just want to throw that hat out there for academics as well, some of which we have heard.
Anyone on the panel want to speak?
Yeah,
to
I just maybe actually to link those two questions. I think in looking at other states, one of the places to look, there aren't that many states that have at this point sort of one single point entry point for open data. But looking at who's doing the GIS work in the state and where the geographers are, because there's a long history of open data in geography, and there's a lot of questions and discussion around authoritative data sources and what those mean. And I think in a number of states, looking at Utah, close to us, they've done a lot of really interesting stuff and linking data to economic development. That was, I think, from a policy perspective, that was something that made a lot of sense for their state. That was something that was very sellable. But it also allowed them to link in a number of different kinds of data sets. And so I think that's a place to look in terms of thinking about both the kind of what open data is available, but also who might be doing interesting data sets, and even if they're not considered the point of entry, might have some really interesting stuff that's kind of hiding and maybe just isn't as well publicized yet.
Great. any other thoughts? We're going to come back to the question here.
Yeah, thanks. So silos, they store grain, right? I looked it up. I'm not a farmer. So they store grain, and so if we're all very interested in breaking down silos, I think we want to do that because we want to cross-pollinate the grain. So if we're going to do that, I don't think we just want to scatter the grain around. I mean, I think you need a model for how you want to achieve that cross-pollination. And so to me, I think that the best entities for either creating open or shared or linked, those are different things, data, typically have some theoretical framework that's guiding the cross-pollination effort or the release effort, right? And that otherwise you sort of end up with all the issues that some of you mentioned around lack of standardization. Well, those standardization of variables, sort of decisions, have to get made under a theoretical notion of what you're trying to achieve and what kinds of questions you're trying to answer with the data. And so you can have a lot of data that's sort of thrown together and stored in one location, but it won't necessarily achieve, I don't think, what you want it to without that kind of theoretical underpinning that describes what you're what you'd like to achieve. So I just wondered if anyone wanted to react to that.
Yeah, I think it's a very interesting point, and it's also the way we designed the interoperability platform, and you'll hear a lot of people working on that right now, but it's very function-driven. Rather than just amassing massive sets of data and aggregating data, we're really looking at function-driven interoperability, and to your point, so function-driven associations of data sets, I think it's very important. To counter that, I would also say that sometimes creating associations creating intersections between data sets, you'll see associations you could have never imagined. And what they might do is not conclusively say cause and effect, but generate a hypothesis that you might not have ever come up with. And so I think both ways it's important that we get more data intersection. But I do feel very strongly about making sure that at least a good portion of it is very function driven. I have been really curious about some of the work that you presented about how do we get to trust the data that we don't traditionally collect in a clinical or research setting. And this question came up for me when I started using more design thinking in the innovation work we're doing, and the whole concept of qualitative research is pretty foreign to us who grew up in the science tracks, but how to gain an appreciation for what is the value in that. There's tremendous value in it. And I like the way that you were trying to help us triage the data in the open data sets. We had to do that with level one, level two, level three evidence anyway. So I think that looking at more systematic ways to approach and appreciate data that's collected in different ways than we might have traditionally done it. Because to be honest, patients are really coming forth. They want to participate, and patient-reported outcomes are very, very valuable. So as much as we have to validate the consumer wearables, we have to figure out how do we make use of that, and maybe we help people put it in more structured or protocolized methodology by giving them better technologies to do that in. But I think continuing to search for the value and create that cultural trust of the information that's out there is really important.
Great. Anyone else want to comment on that?
Sure. Sort of the topic of interoperability, I'll give you an example from HIV, where I think some of the solution has to come from the top down. So for HIV, there's a bunch of federal and state agencies that will fund different kinds of HIV services. Grants, you have to report things in different ways, and it's usually the same exact measure that just gets reported in different ways. So engaged in HIV care, one federal agency might require that it be documented one HIV primary care visit in each 6-month interval. Another agency might say it has to be 4 months apart, and then all of the reporting cycles are totally different, which creates a ton of work for folks at the Department of Health. So the White House eventually sort of convened a panel from the Institute of Medicine, and all we did was actually look at the measures and propose a streamlined set of indicators. I'm actually not sure like how successful that is and how far it's been pushed along, but I think that those are the kinds of efforts that would really help with some data standardization.
Right.
One more quick comment
sure,
on that?
Sure, please.
Just something to think about, I think, when we're when you're collecting data from a state or a county level and going more local is being able to really engage the people who are going to be the data collectors early on. And that was what we did during the broadband project was we had developed an initial data schema, but went through a lot of changes. And actually, it was the state, the National Association of GIS professionals, who were all about 30 of them were actually our direct grantees. They actually created our geodatabase. And then we used that and we adopted that as the standard. But it went through changes throughout its period. And that's really important, especially if you're ever asking people to voluntarily collect data because people were much more engaged because they had an ownership stake.
Great. So we're getting very close to lunchtime, and I always hesitate, but we had one more question, which we will close on. Oh, I'm sorry. We'll have two.
Thank you. Toby Ewing with the California's Mental Health Oversight Commission. So one of the things we've struggled with, but you're beginning to talk a little bit about that, is some intentionality in the design of the data collection on the public sector side, right? So much what we've done is talked about how to create access to data that we've been gathering for other purposes, right? And as an artifact of fiscal reporting or some sort of health reporting said, hey, well, there's some really interesting research things we've done. Have you, I'm curious how we've been able to make progress, where the most progress has been made at the policy level, whether it's legislature or departmental policy, in terms of building in the analytics in the design of the conversation that's going on, as opposed to coming in after the fact and saying, hey, you've got all this great data. Now, how do we make use of that? Are you seeing progress in these other states or the federal level where an analytic conversation is driving the data discussion very early on?
Any of our visitors from places like New York or Maryland want to take a crack? Because I'm gonna leave to the California folks to spend the rest of the day and tomorrow talking about this issue, because it's clearly a good idea.
I'll say that one of the things that popped up in some of our interviews is that some people had mentioned, practitioners, that one of the benefits of open data is that not only their data is getting better as more people are looking at the data and they're forced to fill out some detailed metadata, but now they're thinking differently about how they want to design their data systems prospectively. So knowing that it's hard to extract data from legacy systems for open data purposes. So moving forward, how do they want to create different kinds of data systems?
I'm from California, but could I chime in?
You may.
It wasn't born. I just want to add to that. I think some of it's coming in the technology platforms where research kit, you know, health kit, the different technologies that where people are now starting to be able to enter data and actually track their own health records, et cetera. We're training, actually, consumers to be data scientists now. But the other thing, just to point out, is everyone wants access to the clinical data, and it in itself has quite a bit of problems, because we haven't been entering it in a very well-trained, well-organized, or really forward-thinking way of how that data might be used. As you know, the EHR is created for very different purposes. So we actually need for our clinicians to become data scientists at some level in their training, so they understand how important that information is that they're putting in. So even on the EHR side, we have work to do.
I think so. Thank you. We have the one more. Yes.
So my question is going to be a little bit different in the sense that there's a lot of conversation around academic research, and not really about the applied aspect of the practice that we see often from a local health department perspective. I'll give you a quick example. I was an epidemiologist who, for 12 years, did my community health assessment every 4 years and walked into a room and essentially found a local academician who said, I had the Medicaid hospitalization data by patient level for the past 10, and never knew that this existed, nor was there any opportunity until the individual tried to sell it to my health department. So the point that I'm making is, when we speak about linkages, there are some tremendous opportunities that are missed by those individuals and those agencies who are on the ground trying to improve public health outcomes and are engaged with communities, and oftentimes a lot of the conversation seems to go around them. And don't really engage other than to say, give us your data, or here's what we have. So that's what I wanted to bring up as a question.
I'm not sure there's an answer to that question. It's extremely well framed. Anyone else want to comment, Phil?
So we actually have instituted a reverse research day at Hopkins, where we have the state, both state, city, state agencies, but also NGOs frame their questions, and sometimes they actually talk about their data to meet with the academics to talk about how there can be a better linkage about finding out what sort of example. So again, it's instead of us convening the meeting and having the cells, they sit around, as in this room, around their tables, and people rotate around, and we sort of try to facilitate the discussions between the academics and the community-based organizations about what data are available, how might those things be done, just as a potential strategy to facilitate some of those discussions.
Since the UC system has had more to say here this morning, at Stanford we have actually developed such relationships with all of the counties in the Bay Area, and are doing projects directly with two of the county health authorities in two of those counties. We completely agree with the sentiment of that.